The rising crime graph remained a cause of concern for the citizens, police and the government in October, with increasingly brazen crimes taking place even in broad daylight. The killing of the 35-year-old son of the former director of the National Emergency Management Organization was a chilling reminder that no one was safe from the ruthless killers at large.
My son was gunned down by... He had gone to get something to eat and there was a robbery. My son was a hardworking man. Imagine, he was just living work at that time. He has a joinery shop where he makes caskets. And he was just finishing some, trying to make ends meet for his daughter. Trying to make a life for himself. A loving child, very jovial.
The only thing more worrying than the pitilessness of the shooters was the firepower that they had access to. Discoveries by police and customs officers of AR-15 weapons at the Castries cargo yard and in various police operations were making it clear that the lightweight semi-automatic rifle was quickly becoming the weapon of choice for local killers. The public was looking to the Prime Minister for his strategy to address the situation, but he in turn was pointing at the police to give the answers. Pressure was also mounting from the opposition for the Labour government to take decisive action to arrest the escalating crime situation. Repeated violent altercations within the walls of the island's lone prison were also drawing public criticism of the government. But again, Prime Minister Philip Pierre would blame a lack of leadership at the prison for the frequency of the violent eruptions at the facility. In one instance, video shot behind the walls of the Bodley Correctional Facility showed two inmates beaten and cutting a third. The mere ability of prisoners to record such incidents on cell phones gave rise to even more questions about the security at the facility. Prime Minister Pierre called on the Public Service Commission to fix the situation.
In these matters, you must take yourself out of the office and go and see what's happening on the ground. The Public Service Commission is made up of St. Lucians who live and work here. And I'm hoping again, for the fifth time, they understand the urgency of that Bodley situation. I mean, we have to say thanks to the men and women who work at Bodley. We have to thank them. They're under tremendous pressure. They need leadership. They need clear and decisive leadership. They need to know who the leader is so we can take it from there.
Home Affairs Minister Virginia Albert Poyot had for months been speaking of the need to overhaul the prison. But the management of the facility announced an immediate review of operational procedures at the institution as an interim measure. The Prime Minister's calls for more effective leadership at the prison, as responded to by Albert Poyot, with the announcement that the appointment of a new Director of Corrections was imminent. That individual would eventually be identified as Vern Gard, who had previously served at the BCF, before taking up an overseas job offer. Prime Minister Philip J. Pierre would also announce the appointment of a new female police commissioner who would replace Commissioner Milton Daisy.
I want to thank the Honourable Prime Minister for the confidence he has placed in me to head the organisation at such a challenging time. Let me assure you, sir, that I will do my best. I have not met my executive. I'm looking forward to meet them soon. I'm looking forward to the support of the men and women of the organization to lead whilst I lead the organization.
Crosita Descartes-Pelius would become the island's first female police commissioner, but Pelius would only be serving in an acting capacity and was expected to retire from the police force herself. The appointment raised eyebrows and even more questions, but was welcomed by some, including opposition Senator Herod Stanislaus. He also applauded the new commissioner for her tough talk about addressing sexual harassment within the police force. The calls for stronger gun trafficking laws to enable law enforcement to crack down on gun traffickers were renewed, along with appeals for even stiffer penalties than those contained in more recent amendments to the Firearms Act. The need to get the guns off the street was underscored by the shooting death of 16-year-old Foasho Secondary School student Miguela Joseph. She was shot dead, allegedly by her 21-year-old sister, with what was widely reported to be an unlicensed firearm. Alicia George was formally charged with the killing. At this point, the island's homicide figures were already in the 50s, and the killings showed no sign of stopping or slowing down. Apart from the shootings, police also had their hands full with other crimes, including those against business, and which were equally brazen in nature. From bakeries to laboratories, everybody was a target. Toward the end of October, bandits armed with machetes attacked and robbed tourists staying at a guest house in Anseleray. By this time, and perhaps in an indication of the level of public frustration with the crime situation, one of the perpetrators was caught and beaten by residents. The arrest of Senate President Stanley Felix in October raised several eyebrows and moved the opposition United Workers Party to demand that Prime Minister Philip Pierre relieve Felix of his post. Days later, the Prime Minister did just that, leaving Felix to deal with his legal troubles and the government to begin the search for his replacement.
Stanley Felix is on bail and is dealing with his defense. In our law says you're innocent until proven guilty. She's at home.
So how come he was fired if he's innocent until proven guilty?
No, because you know we've said that we give him time to see about his legal matters.
But the identification and appointment of a replacement proved a little more troublesome and faced some challenges. Despite the Prime Minister's swift action in relieving Felix of his senatorial duties, opposition leader Alan Chasney continued to take issue with the Prime Minister's handling of the situation.
I was intrigued by the Prime Minister's statement on the afternoon. So here it is that Stanley Felix was detained at Babineau at 10 o'clock in the morning. And it wasn't until about 5 o'clock in the afternoon that the Prime Minister put out a missive from his office. A missive that said nothing. Now, remember, he's not only the Prime Minister, but he's also the Minister of National Security. So you're saying to me that I'm to believe that you did not know anything before 10 o'clock, and certainly by the time it happened at 10 o'clock, that between 10 o'clock and 5 o'clock, you could not find any information.
But it wasn't long before the opposition leader himself found himself in the spotlight when he was summoned before the Privileges Committee of the House of Assembly. The first time in the history of St. Lucia that a sitting member of parliament was being summoned to appear before the body. Chasney was being asked to answer to two separate complaints brought against him for statements made in the House of Assembly. But he had questions about the ability of the committee, given its composition, to grant him a fair hearing.
I don't know that I've spoken to anyone who believes going to a system or a situation in which I'm going to be judged by my peers in Parliament, of which the majority of persons on that panel are going to be from the Labour Party. And to believe that we've reached a point of maturity in our life where persons can derobe themselves of their loyalty and dedication to the Labour Party, to sit objectively and listen to what the claims are. So, to think at this point that the vote coming out of that committee, and more than likely the vote coming out of Parliament, would be anything other than down party lines, then we have an understanding of where this thing is heading.
He was joined by opposition senators Dominic Fede and Ferra Polius, who denounced the entire proceeding, calling it an elaborate attempt by the Labour administration to distract the public from its own ineptitude and failures as a government. Attorneys representing the leader of the opposition, Alan Chasney, would file for injunction in the High Court to stay the hearings on the grounds that Chasney's right to fundamental fairness and natural justice had been denied him. This as well as claims of overreach of power on the part of House Speaker Claudius Francis were highlighted as grounds to nullify the hearings. The hearings were subsequently cancelled.
The Speaker took it upon himself to send it to the Privileges Committee. He never articulated to me in writing what I was being accused of and what standing order am I in breach of. And so we pointed those procedural matters out to him. And I'm very disappointed because after he received that information, late on Friday afternoon, he sent us a letter in which he copied his attorneys, basically saying that there was nothing wrong in the procedures and they're going to continue. And we then had to take the course of action over the weekend to prepare a complaint to the courts and asking the courts to intercede and imposing an injunction on the speaker from proceeding down this course. So this morning, before the case was to be heard, government side contacted the speaker's attorneys contacted my attorney, indicating that they now recognize the flaws that they were attempting to do, and the speaker has agreed to withdraw those things. But I'm very happy to report that the court proceeded in filing an injunction anyway. I think that the speaker and the parliament had ample time to have resolved this issue a proper way. I don't think that we can just take their word that they were going to withdraw this as being sufficient. So the courts have ordered an injunction preventing the speaker from proceeding on this particular matter.
But Chastney was mindful that the complaints against him could be resubmitted. And indeed they were. However, this time there would be changes to the composition of the Privileges Committee, which would preside over the proceedings. But again, Chastney accused the House Speaker of more procedural missteps and violations of the Constitution.